Hey, I hear that music, and normally that means it's time for our weekly episode of Pop Culture Happy Hour. But today it means something different.
Today it means you are going to hear Pop Culture Happy Hour in a completely different way.
Yep, I am your host, Linda Holmes.
And I'm Stephen Thompson.
And we are thrilled to be sharing with you some of our favorite stories that shine and make us laugh.
And to introduce you to some of our favorite special guests.
Oh, that's pretty good. The thing is, this is a big moment because this is one of your first opportunities to take a piece of Pop Culture Happy Hour with you. It's our very first artifact.
That is right. It is your first chance to own a piece of the show. And another thing, this collection is a great way of circumventing having to explain what a podcast is.
That's right. That is correct. And when you listen to these two CDs, somewhere in there, I'm going to tell a joke about a raisin. I'm just promising that right now. Somewhere in there, I am going to tell a joke about a raisin.
You're just assuming this?
No, I'm promising it because that will be your bonus content. Everybody deserves bonus content.
Okay.
We're giving you a joke about a raisin. It's coming sometime in the next two CDs. I'm not telling you where.
I'll try to look surprised.
That's right. We're going to start off this collection with, naturally, with a segment that we did on debuts that was with our friend Ari Shapiro, NPR correspondent. You may have heard him reporting from Europe or hosting various shows. And with us, he talks about twerking and the Video Music Awards, and in this case, about pop culture debuts. I cannot speak for anyone else, but as I got thinking about debuts, I got thinking about what exactly we mean when we say a debut.
Sure.
Because very rarely is the thing you think of as someone's debut or that you might refer to that way. Very rarely is that the actual first thing they ever did.
Oh, interesting. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right?
Right.
It sort of plays into our narrative in which show business is by magic, where people are gifted and so they just suddenly sort of shine down on you like, Ma, Julia
Emerging
Roberts.
From the water
exactly.
on a clamshell.
Julia Roberts comes up on a clamshell. Whereas in fact, a lot of times, they've already done a bunch of little small things. I don't know. What are you thinking, Thompson?
Yeah, I mean, that's one reason that some of the first stuff that popped into my head when we were talking about really notable debuts, and I just kind of went, I definitely gravitated more toward great debuts. Debuts that immediately revealed some sort of, like, everybody just knew.
Yeah.
And a couple of movies that sprung immediately to mind were Pi. By Darren Aronofsky, and Duel by Steven Spielberg. And what both of those movies have in common, and those really are, I mean, I'm sure there were student films, but those were very, very early. Uh-huh. They were extremely low budget. Pi was $60,000 to make. I don't remember what Duel cost, but it's a very lean, very contained movie.
Oh, I was thinking of Life of Pi. I was like, wow, that's cheap for all that CGI.
I was going to say, $60,000, I think 3 seconds of Life of Pi cost more than
$60,000. I think just the tail cost $60,000.
There were individual hairs on the tiger's body that cost $60,000 a second to animate. No, Pi.
Sorry, go on.
Anyway, the science fiction film.
Mathematics.
Pi, yes. And what is interesting about those movies, and Spielberg certainly went on to make tons and tons of amazing, amazing films. I think Aronofsky, I think we would agree, is a spottier director.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And what's interesting to me about Aronofsky, looking at him as somebody who made that movie for $60,000 and has most recently made Noah for nine figures, which is very widely considered a much less artistically successful
That has
production.
Been an option for me on so many transatlantic plane flights, and I have not once exercised the option.
Don't do it.
I think that one of the things that I found interesting in assessing debuts is the musicians, the filmmakers, where they're very constrained by their budgets, but their budgets force incredible creativity. Like, I mean, this is a weird example, but we've talked several times on this show. I've been watching a lot of Cutthroat Kitchen. And go with me on this.
Be with me, people.
So it's a cooking competition where there are sabotages. And what you often see on that show is a chef is forced to do something that would seem impossible, that you can't imagine how they would cok this dish on the underside of a wok turned upside down. But that constraint causes them to do something creative that a chef working next to them with no sabotages will do something less interesting because they have every opportunity at their disposal. And I think that working within creative confines enforces a certain creativity. And I think one reason that sometimes debuts seem better than, you know, mid-late career projects is because that limitation is absolutely forces them to be creative.
Wow, freedom is a handicap. What an interesting idea.
I think that is, there are many cases in which freedom is a handicap.
Mm. Well, you know, I was looking, I was just coming up with a bunch of novels that were debuts just off the top of my head. And as I did, I noticed that basically the entire ninth grade summer reading list are all debut novels. Sense and Sensibility, Jane Eyre, Wuthering Heights, The Hobbit, Martian Chronicles, To Kill a Mockingbird, One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, Night, Frankenstein, Catch-22, Bell Jar, Invisible Man, Catcher in the Rye, The Bluest Eye.
Wow.
They're all debut novels. If you want to go a little bit more recent, then all these novels that make a big splash, that are the darlings of the book club circuit, Kite Runner, Everything is Illuminated, A Heartbreaking Work of Staggering Genius, Persepolis, Less Than Zero, The Secret History, Curious Incident of the Dog at Nighttime, Train Spotting, Girl with the Dragon Tattoo. Mm-hmm. All of these are debut novels. And I think some of it is that the old saw is that the first novel is inspiration. Everything else is invention and
they
inspiration.
Say the same thing about cookbooks.
Exactly, exactly. I think it's that we as a society are just hungering for fresh meat, new bioflesh. We want the new thing.
But there is some truth to the fact that your debut novel is going to be the one that you've been working on
That's
for
exactly
20 years. And
the
I think
I
there's some of that in debut filmmaking, too, that, you know, for some people, there really is the dream project that they think about for years, and they don't necessarily have five more just like them.
Yeah.
You know, that's your big idea, and some find it easier than others to do the next thing.
Well, and this comes up in music all the time. Part of it is that albums tend to be loose collections of songs that come from a lot of different places, and a musician's first album is going to be cherry-picked from their entire life up until that point. I mean, a great debut album that pops into my head is like Tracy Chapman's first record,
sure,
which is a fantastic, wonderful record that I fell in love with as a teenager. It was very formative for me. And her second record, Crossroads, which came out like 2 years later, can't come close because those are songs that were written during and after her entire life up until that point. Mm-hmm. And very often you find with second and third records that the songs feel like reactions to the success of the first record. Mm. And that's just never as interesting as an entire life up until that point.
Hmm. Okay, so Stephen gravitated towards film directors, Glenn gravitated towards novelists. I started thinking about actors, and specifically, I thought about actors who have become so meta, almost such parodies of themselves in the spotlight, who actually had really promising debuts in their first films that then got so caught up in the machine of Hollywood that they transformed into something else, almost becoming their own character. Perhaps because her face is all over the London Metro now, because she's starring in a new play in London. It's a production of David Mamet's Speed the Plow. The first person to come to mind was, any guesses?
Not a one.
Should we play the tape?
I have a brilliant, beyond brilliant idea. I think we should switch places. When camp's over, I'll go back to London as you, and you go back to California as me. Hallie, we're totally and completely 100% different. So,
poor little thing.
Oh. Lilo. It's Lindsay Lohan in the remake of The Parent Trap.
She's promising, right? She's very cute in that movie, and she continued to be very cute. She was very cute in Mean Girls, and she was a very likable, I think, child actress.
No one ever said she was a bad actress.
No,
I think she's very engaging.
We are on
movie.
Record on this show as rooting for Lindsay Lohan.
And then
for the eventual Lilo
comeback. For the resurrection of Lindsay Lohan.
The other performance that came to mind from an actress who has almost become so meta, although in a very different way from Lindsay Lohan, was in a film that is so vulgar we literally could not find a clip to play that would be appropriate. But it was Chloe Sevigny in the movie Kids. And today, when I think of Chloe Sevigny, I think of her on a runway at Fashion Week, or I think of Drew Drogi doing Good Evening America, I'm Chloe Sevigny.
Good Evening America, I'm Chloe Sevigny. It's recently come to my attention that I love birthdays. I recently had my birthday party. And you might ask me, Chloe, what did you receive? First of all, I got a vintage half caftan by Vivienne Westwood Gold Label, imitation pants by Cacharel, and a high-heeled purse by Little Tic Tac.
you know, whatever the, those videos are that he does. And yet she had incredible, and still does to some extent, have incredible performances before she was, all caps, Chloe Sevigny,
right,
in Kids.
Yeah. And I guess the funny thing is, and I don't know what it says about me, but I eventually started thinking about wanting to defend the idea of inauspicious debuts or kind of unimportant debuts. I think the idea of the big splashy debut emphasizes all of the inspiration part in art and creativity and none of the work part, none of the learning part.
Right.
And so for me, when people sort of assume, oh, this debut announced that this person had arrived, it's almost like you're expecting that the person is supposed to show up fully formed, knowing everything they're ever going to know. And a lot of times you do get that idea of the arc where it's sort of just everything is downhill from there, right? I've never loved, you know, Alicia Silverstone again after Clueless. And I steal that observation a little bit from a conversation I had with my friend Alan Sepinwall, who was talking about trying to think about debut performances that, you know, were not followed by tons of other things people loved. And of course, again, as I said before, Clueless, not really her debut, but her debut in the debutante sense.
Sure.
You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Like, a debutante has existed before she's a debutante, but this is your presentation,
right?
And Clueless was Alicia Silverstone's presentation. But when I think about debuts, a lot of times you do go back, and this is one of the things I love about looking at, like, IMDb profiles, is that when you look at an IMDb profile of an actor, you often just go back and back and back and back, and you just fall through these layers of where you realize that, like, they actually worked hard to become good.
Mm-hmm.
And I have the utmost respect for that. And every now and then, and I very much came across this by happenstance as I was researching this question, but there was a 1999, very little noticed television show called Get Real, which I think ran for one season. According to IMDb, the actual screen debuts of both a young teenage actress by the name of Anne Hathaway and a young actor by the name of Jesse Eisenberg.
Oh, wow.
Not a show that everyone simultaneously said, what an amazing television show. They started off working in a TV show. Pre-Princess Diaries. In a regular, plain old television show. And there are tons of people whose debuts were from soaps, including a lot of people who later became very good actresses. Robin Wright, I first saw in a soap. Julianne Moore, I first saw in a soap. And those people, you know, you work to become good. And I think there is honor in working to become good and in not looking back at your debut and saying, boy, I was amazing.
Yeah. I wonder with hindsight if you would look back at Julianne Moore's performance in that soap opera and say, in this sea of mediocrity, she was a diamond in the rough.
Well, that's always the
question. To mix a metaphor.
I sort of wrote that essay one time about Michelle Williams having been on Dawson's Creek. And I kind of said, your only choices really are either Dawson's Creek wasn't as bad as you thought it was, or there's such of a thing as being a good actress on a bad show, or you can't be a good actress no matter how good you are if the show isn't good, or there's such a thing as starting out as not that strong of an actress and becoming a better actress.
And I'm sure depending on the case, any one of those can be the situation.
Well, of course. And speaking of that exact same show, Josh Jackson is in a new Showtime show that's did Fringe for a long time, but now is in a kind of a super high prestige Showtime drama. You have to kind of accept at some point that the debut is only what it is. Do you know what I'm saying? Am I making any sense?
No, you're absolutely making sense. And I also think that a gigantically auspicious debut can haunt you your entire career for some of the same reasons.
Josh Hartnett, Pearl Harbor.
Right, sure. Well,
that's a good point. Ben Affleck, Pearl Harbor. He had done others.
But I mean, people who come out with what is considered their masterwork and it's their first album. When was the last time people loved something Liz Phair did? Well, Liz Phair's first album, Exile in Guyville, is a classic. But ever since, people have been in this perpetual state of being disappointed in Liz Phair. You could list all sorts of bands who've, you know, who've just never quite matched that, like, perfect debut. And so they're haunted by it, and they're sort of forced to always reference it in ways that can be challenging.
Yeah, I might not lump Pearl Harbor in with Liz Phair's first album.
It's the melodious voice of Ari Shapiro. And have you ever noticed that public radio voices do have a certain sound to them? We've noticed that. A lot of other people have noticed it. And in this next episode, we talk about why that is with two of our regular guests on the show, with NPR's Code Switch lead blogger, Gene Demby, and also NPR producer, Tanya Ballard Brown. There was an essay that came out. It was an.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.